Tonight on Writer's Showcase, our writers and actors take us all over Alaska, from a floating house on the tumultuous waters of Southeast to a ragtag group of kids navigating their lives in rural Kenai. Watch as our writers and actors take prose to new places, right here on Writer's Showcase. Good evening. I'm your host, Scott Burton. Originally, we intended tonight's show to be open-themed, but somehow, after the writing came together, the theme of ingenuity surfaced and couldn't be ignored. In this short story from her book, Bear Down, Bear North, writer Melinda Moustakis introduces us to a group of resourceful kids who learn about the harsh realities of life and death all too soon. Note that some language has been changed for broadcast. Reading Moustakis's Us Kids, please welcome Donnie Gott.
Us kids smile and wave good riddance when Fox and Uncle Sly roll out one way and we roll another, bruised butts in the seats. We're piled into Big Mary, our station wagon that barely fits us all and is a miracle for starting up. We're packed in with a huge pot full of frozen moose meat and whatever we have to eat in the back, along with a jumble ball of Afghans. Polar Bear is always knitting. Fox and Uncle Sly go hunting at the homestead, and Polar Bear drives us to see Aunt Sheila and Jack and Gracie, our cousins, at the house that Uncle Sly built, all googly-eyed and drunk. The house has gone through a few names, Slack Shack, Plywood Palace, and the one we all remember and still use is the Tilton Hilton. Aunt Sheila has made gumdrop cookies, and she sets a plate of them on the porch. We're pressed to see or taste any gumdrops, but Kitty holds up hers. I see a green one. Polar Bear takes the pot and Afghans into the house, and we know to stay put outside. Aunt Sheila draws the curtains, but we know what they're doing, smoking and drinking homemade cranberry lick. We huddle near the side and listen through the cheap cracked wood. The men are good and gone, says Polar Bear. Ben signs to Rias so he can hear too. Jack shushes Gracie. Maybe they'll do us a favor and shoot themselves, says Aunt Sheila. Maybe, says Polar Bear. I'll drink to that. There's a clink of bottles. JJ crosses his eyes and raises an imaginary bottle to his lips. Colleen, who has baby tea on her hip, laughs into her hand. They talk stars and moonlight in the beginning, says Aunt Sheila. And what we get is crap and moonshine, says Polar Bear. Another clink, a smash of glass on the floor. Kitty gives out a yelp. God damn it, says Polar Bear. We huddle closer to the house. I hear you out there, Polar Bear says. You leave us alone. Scramola, we'll call you for dinner. So we scramola. In front of the Tilton Hilton are two hills, one on each side because Sly had meant to put the house on one and the crapper on the other. Nothing better than elevation, he said, but he never got to it. Built the house so it was some leaning wobbler between two piles of dirt. He didn't let Fox help him with the house. He did let Fox build the outhouse behind it, near the woods, and it's the only thing that stands up straight. But the hills are perfect for a game of Red Rover, and a rain has started up, which puts the mosquitoes to bed for a bit. We call JJ over, and he comes mud-slipping down the hill to the arm-linked chain. But Rias and Colleen, with baby T on her hip, keep hold. Gracie and Jack and Kitty come to the bottom and join JJ, and they make a wall. And the others head up the hill. We call Rias over. And because he might not see to lip read with all the rain, JJ draws an R in the air. Here slides Rias on his belly, and he gets up and he charges the line, breaking through Jack and Gracie's link. So he steals Kitty, and now it's Rias and Kitty and Ben and Colleen and baby T at the bottom of the hill. We call Gracie over. Soon we're all mud creatures, which is good because the rain stops and the mosquitoes wake up and swarm around us and the sun streaks through the shiner-eyed clouds. Dinner! Yells Polar Bear, and she sees us kids all rolled and covered in mud. Stay off the porch, she says, but she takes baby tea. We settle on the gravel by the steps with our bowls of moose chili, and for once there's something moose about it. Colleen, you make sure everyone gets hosed off after everyone eats, says Polar Bear, swimming through her words. A high-pitched screaming wail makes us all stop with our spoons. Aunt Sheila comes wobble running round the tilt and Hilton. She steadies herself on the steps and sits down. What is going on? Says Polar Bear. There's a bird or something in the crapper, says Aunt Sheila, all boozy and soft. And it's trapped and it's dying and I pissed on it. She starts crying her face off. We have got to get it out. We just have to. For God's sake, says Polar Bear. It's a bird. What's it matter if the world's shy one? She waves the mosquitoes near her face. But it's alive, says Aunt Sheila. She's a crying mess. Okay, says Polar Bear. Let's go take a look at this bird you pissed on. I didn't know it was down there, says Aunt Sheila. We jump up and follow Polar Bear, the whole mud-covered line of us. Aunt Sheila trails behind, walking zigzag, and Ben falls back to help her. Polar Bear turns around. Sheila, that smell! I know, says Aunt Sheila. The crapper smells like a crapper, even from way off, because of the rain and because they ran out of lye a couple of days before, and Uncle Sly kept forgetting to buy some. Polar Bear gives baby tea to Colleen and goes in to take a look. It's a dumb buzzard, she says. That's all. We take turns, plug our noses, and look down the hole that's surrounded in white styrofoam so it's warm to sit on in the winter. And because Fox made it, it's deep like he made our outhouse at the homestead. There's some flapping and some splashing and a hoarse whistling peep of a bird down there. But it's hard to tell what it is because it's dark in the crapper. We got a flashlight in Big Mary, so Ben goes to find it, and Polar Bear takes baby tea and Aunt Sheila back to the house. Promise me you'll get them out, says Aunt Sheila. They promise, says Polar Bear. Ben shines the flashlight, and our dried mud faces must scare the bird because it's squawking. Not that the bird is much to look at either, covered in a slop of years of dirt and piss and crap. Get me a shovel, says Ben. Jack goes to find one that's under the house. By this time, we've breathed enough of the smell to get used to it, and we've stopped plugging our noses. Ben has JJ hold the flashlight as he leans in the hole with the shovel, but comes up quick. That's not going to do it, he says. We need something to reach farther. I gotta go, says Gracie. Colleen takes her and Kitty into the woods, and she goes into the house and brings out a broom and a colander. Polar Bear and Aunt Sheila and the baby are lying down. We need tape, says Ben, and he and Jack and JJ and Rias crawl under the tilt and Hilton looking for tape in the scattering of Uncle Sly's tools. Colleen holds the flashlight so Gracie and Kitty can look down the hole. He's crying, says Gracie. Little bird, don't you cry, sings Kitty. He's probably hungry, says Colleen. Ben comes back, holding a dusty roll of duct tape. It's late, but the sun just doesn't quit in July. The mud dries, pale and cracked on our skin. We tape the broom handle to the shovel, and Ben holds JJ's legs as JJ goes into the hole, and Jack holds the flashlight. Pull me out, says JJ. We need about this much more. And he taps the tip of his fingers, using his arm as a measuring stick. The shovel has reached the bird's head, but we need to scoop him out. Get the rake, says Ben. Rake, broom, shovel is taped together. JJ goes in. Ben has him by the ankles. And Rias funnels down the tool. Stop, yells JJ. We're losing the shovel. Ben motions to Rias, who brings up the rake. Hold right there, says JJ. I gotta hold on to the shovel and to you, and you gotta bring us both up. The tape on the joint has come loose. Think about smacked the bird in the head, and then he got me with it. And there's a spot on his forehead where the dry, caked mud is scraped away. Goddamn crap hole! We taped together a stronger rap. This is the last time I'm going, says JJ. We get JJ in, and then the shovel and the rest. I got him, he says. Pull up, pull up! There's a squawk and a splash. He jumped, says JJ. The stupid bird jumped off! He peers down the hole. I am just trying to help you, you piece of crap! JJ, calm down, says Colleen. He slaps the side of the outhouse. Rias raises his hand. Okay, says Ben. You try. We lower Rias, who is holding the end of the rake broom shovel, into the hole. He gets the bird on, and we're lifting up, and we hear a bigger squawk, and then nothing. The bird is not on the shovel because he's holding it. Crap and all, close to his chest, both of them upside down. Ben gets Rias up close to the top and then lifts him out and the bird straight up out of the hole. Jack grabs the bird and it's screaming and Rias stands up and takes the bird back, nestling it in the colander and cradling it in the crook of his arm. He pets it on the top of the head, and if birds could smile, this bird would have been smiling, "You're a saint, love beams," at Rias. That's not a buzzard, says Colleen. Look at that beak. That's an eagle, an eaglet. Still ugly, says JJ. Let's wash him up, says Colleen. We fill a bucket of water at the pump. As long as Rias pets his head, the eaglet, sitting in the colander, lets us pour small cups of water over him. He's about the size of a chicken, with yellow feet and yellow at the base of his hooked beak. With the slop off him, his feathers are grays and browns with white spots on the fringe of his back. All in all, he could be mistaken for a scraggled patch of burr fur, and of bear fur, and he wiggles off the water and ruffles up. We find a towel, and Rias bundles him. Colleen brings over a half-eaten bowl of moose chili and hands the spoon to Rias. See if he's hungry, she says. He is. He opens his beak and gobbles down the chili. Rias pets his head, and then Kitty feeds the eaglet. Here you go, little bird, she says. Here you go, piss bird, says JJ, his voice pure syrup. Piss bird, chimes Jack. And then Jack and JJ chant together, piss bird, piss bird, piss bird. That's enough, says Colleen. He doesn't know what we're saying, says JJ. Hey, pretty, he says. Hey, ugly. See? Leave him alone, says Kitty. He's just a baby. We count, and the eaglet sits in the colander on Rias's lap and eats 11 spoonfuls of chili. I want to keep him, says Gracie. We can't, says Colleen. We could teach him to hunt rabbits for us, says Jack. Or scratch people's eyes out, says JJ. What if he grew up big, says Kitty, and we could ride him? We'd go up to the sky, says Gracie, to the mountains. You'd still smell the crapper up there, says JJ. We have to take him back, says Colleen. There's a nest in the woods that's been abandoned for 3 years, but we figure the eagles must have returned, even if Jack says they haven't seen any flying over like they used to. Where else could this eagle have come from, says Ben. We march past the outhouse into the woods, Rias carrying the eaglet in the colander. We stand at the base of a tall spruce tree, the tangled nest of branches high up near the top. I see something, says Jack. And then we all see a white spot of bald eagle. They must be flying in from a different direction, says Ben. There's no way we can climb the tree and put the eagle back in the nest. He must have fallen or got tired or tried to fly and gotten pushed out, but how he got into the crapper, we don't know. We'll leave him here, says Ben. His parents will hear him. But I wanted to keep him, says Gracie, and she buries her face against Rias. But he needs to be here, honey, says Colleen. Well, I wanted to keep him too, says Kitty. But his family will miss him, says Colleen. Ben gives the signal, and Rias unwraps the eaglet and places him on the ground. Shouldn't we leave the colander, says Colleen. He seemed to like it. Rias puts the colander on the ground, and the eaglet jumps back into it. He strokes the feathers on the eaglet's chest. Say goodbye, says Colleen. Kitty and Gracie kneel down next to Rias. "Goodbye, little bird," they say. JJ shakes his head at their sniffling. Colleen grabs his arm. "Hush," she says. We walk away, Rias the last one to leave. And when he does, the eaglet starts screeching, and it's a good thing Rias can't hear him, or anything for that matter, or he'd turn back. We pick up our pace, the sky falling blue through the trees. We're all still a mud mess, but we're tired. "We'll sleep in Big Mary," says Colleen, "so we don't get in trouble for being all mucked up in the Tilton Hilton." She sneaks inside and grabs the jumble ball of Afghans. We put Gracie and Kitty in the front because they're small and the rest of us can cram on the floor and the seats and the hatch in the back. We pull the Afghans over our heads to block out the light that's tricking us to stay awake. In the late morning, maybe afternoon, we wake up because Jack gets up to go to the outhouse. Big Mary smells like big crap. We crawl out of the car dusty and cricked and yawning, and no one says anything about what's in the front of the porch. The house is quiet, except for the breeze of a snore we know is polar bear. What is there to say? JJ throws a cup of water on Ben, and Ben chases after him, and we all get cups and throw water splashing off the mud we've been wearing since the night before, dirty rivers trickling down to our toes. And what Polar Bear and Aunt Sheila see, bleary-eyed, their hands raised against the glare of the sun, is us kids laughing and running over a torn to pieces eaglet that we bathed and fed and found this morning, brought back to us by birds or dogs or the upside-down nest of the world, stomping what we saved into the ground, an eagle buried under our feet, a flurry of feathers rising up.
In this next piece, our setting is a small, remote harbor somewhere in Southeast. Writer Ed Sasser illuminates that no matter how rural we live, we still need community and a hot tub. Reading Sasser's Soaking in Borrowed Time, please welcome Brandon Demery.
Eddie's Chuck, Alaska sits midway up the shortest fjord between Ketchikan and Skagway. It is populated by people possessed of a unique resilience that allows them not only to tolerate but to celebrate the hardships of living there. Like most of Alaska, Eddie's Chuck was built by one of two types of people. One, those who had seen it done once, or two, those who were filling in for the day for someone who said that they had. Anybody can get to Eddie's Chuck anytime they choose to. All they need to do is click their heels together three times and ask, "I wonder where the pilot can land in all this fog." The float plane will drop you in the harbor, and you are most likely to be met by some of the local folk. It could be Brent, waiting for a package from Marine Exhaust Systems of Alabama so he can leave the harbor. Or it could be Larry, who thinks it's his job to tie up everything that enters the harbor. Or it could be me. I'm just nosy. On this particular day, Brent's part arrived, and he was now ready to make an announcement to the rest of the harbor residents. Brent and Sheila have been living on borrowed time since I met them. The 63-foot converted steel work tug borrowed time. The trouble was they couldn't leave the transient dock without losing their moorage. If they left in borrowed time and another boat came into their spot, they would lose phone and electrical hookups. They borrowed a boat when they wanted to get underway to fish or sail. Finding that to be too much of an impingement to their chosen cruising lifestyle, they elected to untie the Springs lines last month. They wanted to spend 3 months anchoring out while on a slow trip to Ketchikan, where Sheila's teaching job would start with a new semester. That was Brent's announcement. During the send-off party, we all sequentially realized something that soon cast a pall over the festivities. Theirs was the only hot tub in the harbor. What were we to do now? None of the other boats were currently configured properly to accommodate a hot tub. Depression turned to speculation and finally to a partial enthusiasm. Larry and Stan suggested a floating tub that we could take turns using. It could move from boat to boat, and one of us could register it with the harbor master as the ship's tender. Eyes rolled. There was moaning and gnashing of teeth. But Stan and Larry were drawing out the concept on the back of an old Salmon Landing report using a carpenter's pencil Larry always carried in his overalls. "Okay with us? You don't want to do a co-op kind of deal?" Larry exclaimed, laughing off the good-natured derision. "We'll just rent it out to you." We all went back to our refreshments. I didn't think much of it till the next morning when Stan rang my bow bell with his boat pole and asked to borrow my circular saw and my drill and some carriage bolts. And did I have one of those things that fit in the drill but really sawed a big round hole? Looking up at the dock, I couldn't believe what I saw. "Mainland lumber?" I asked Stan. "Where on earth did you get milled lumber?" Most everything on the island was done in rough-cut lumber from Bob Clancy's sawmill, and here were more than a sling of cedar 2x6s challenging the leaf springs of Stan's pickup. "Fell off a barge," was all Larry could say as he hefted another 3 sticks down the ramp. Of course, this was the second lowest tide of the year, so they were lugging the entire materials list for their rent-a-tub, an extra 23 vertical feet each trip. "You sure you don't want to wait for the -4.9 next month?" I asked them. Stan caught on and winked, but Larry said this couldn't wait. They told me I could use their rent-a-tub for free in exchange for the loan of tools. Seemed like a bargain to me just to have them out of my hair for a week. The project didn't come up in conversation on my boat till several days later when I needed to borrow my drill back so I could mount my new EPIRB. I started towards Stan's barrel boat, figuring Larry would be around there someplace with my tools. On the way, I heard the laboring of a small outboard motor and looked up to see what was going on. I saw 4 naked bodies in a more or less partially stabilized, neutrally buoyant, full displacement, floating hot tub with a wood-fired stove bellowing like a steam engine. My first thought was, they have customers. They're actually renting this thing out. As the tub got closer to Stan's boat and the driver began tying up, I recognized both the clothed driver and the naked soakers as harbor residents, either liveaboards or visiting cruisers. Larry and Stan came out of Stan's boat beaming like new fathers. "Take a turn, it's free to you." Stan offered me the painter, this mobile hot tub's bow line. I more or less averted my eyes as the mixed soakers wrapped in towels then stayed to chat with him. One of them had provided the stove, another some fittings, another the outboard. They had all contributed something and hadn't paid any rent. It turns out upwards of 20 people had some sort of investment in the tender and were exempt from rent. In fact, I couldn't think of anyone left in or anywhere around the harbor who would likely be a regular paying customer. I took the painter and called across the harbor for my better half to join me in a soak. While I waited, Larry broke out a can of paint and a brush to give the tender its name. Borrowed Time 2. I caught Larry's good eye and said, "Guess it turned out to be a co-op kind of deal after all."
Our next selection by Vivian Faith-Prescott examines the oftentimes difficult conflict between cultural preservation and change. Note that some language has been modified for broadcast. Reading Prescott's House Falling into the Sea, please welcome Frank Henry Kosh Katasse.
Charlie Johns knew it was going to be a strange year when he found a three-headed dandelion blooming in mid-October. Charlie sat drinking his coffee in front of a picture window at his home on Petroglyph Beach. His dog, Osa, an old Australian shepherd, sat beside him. Charlie was Wushkitan, eagle from the shark house. He is called Anguch, the keeper or backbone of the land. His mother was from Huna, but he lived in Wrangell all his life. His father was Kafkliayi Hit, house lowered from the sky. Here, Charlie lived among people from the Sun House and the Dogfish Intestine House, as well as the Norwegians, the Finns, the Sami, the Filipinos, and even the Chinese and Japanese. There were Vikings, wizards, bears, Seakoi, dragons, and Susanoo. The best thing, though, about living in Wrangell was living among stories. He practically lived at the coffee shop. Their stories lived there, and at the gas pump, at the float house, and at Shake's Island, and among the petroglyphs beside his house. Since Jesse, his wife of many years, had died, he began to spend his time among rocks, wandering with his thermos of coffee along the beach. He knew exactly where Raven Stealing the Sun story was carved, as well as the spiral and the killer whale. But he worried lately about the beach and the erosion happening all along Alaska's coastline. The previous winter, the ice floe broke loose from the Stikeen in March. Early breakup, they called it. He didn't believe it. But the large sheet of ice came around the corner, then along the shoreline, and smashed onto his beach. The tides were higher these past few years and the storms stronger. In fact, the sea had eroded the shore so many times that he had to move his house back 2 times in the last 20 years. It wasn't just Wrangell. It was Shishmaref, Sitka, Tenneke, New Toke, villages on the Ninglick River, and more. Now, Charlie sat down in the wet sand, tucking his raincoat under his butt. He held his thermos in his gloved hand and took a big sip of coffee. The gulls circled overhead, which made him feel comfortable since Jessie had been a seagull. She was Tokteng Tan. Some people called her a kittiwake, but she was old school and claimed she was a seagull. He looked up and screeched back at them. Every morning since Jessie's death, he'd made a point to check up on the rocks. Someone had to. Someone had to take care of them. Jesse used to clean up the beach. She'd pick up Pepsi cans and white plastic grocery bags. Now it was his turn, he supposed. A sad turn, but he'd take it. He'd take anything that would still connect him to Jesse. He started by just trying to sit among the rocks, but he couldn't ignore the garbage. Once he'd found remnants of a small fire and a pile of beer bottles. Another time, a roll of butcher paper that people used to make rubbings of the petroglyphs lying wet and soggy on the beach. He found orange letters sprayed across a petroglyph that wasn't even something profound. The numbers 1995. Now that really pissed him off. These were his people's petroglyphs. At least that's how he thought of them. He often had words with the tour guides and the town fathers when they claimed they didn't know who carved the petroglyphs. They were his ancestors. He knew this. It was as if the white folks were saying that the land around here really wasn't Thlinkit territory because they weren't here first. You migrated here, and so did we. Sometimes he had to stop the tourists from defacing the petroglyphs. At first, he simply stood on the porch with his rifle in his hand. And that's when the cops got involved and told him not to scare the visitors. They don't call them tourists anymore. The government had made the beach a state historic site, and all that did was bring more people there. Some protection. One day, the government sent his nephew, Johan, to talk to him. You're in trouble, Uncle, for telling folks there's a limit per day and they can't go down there? Sure he'd done that. It was clever. But he was the first one there in the morning, standing on their newfangled platform and boardwalk, telling tourists that the place was closed for reservations or renovations, or they had reached their visitor limit already, or they had to go to the imaginary ticket booth in town and get a ticket. They always believed him. Who'd think an old man like him would be a liar? You were so lying, Uncle Johns, his nephew Johan had chuckled. Now, Charlie looked up at the typical clouds shrouding the mountains. No, he didn't mind local folks coming down to the beach making petroglyph rubbings. He loved seeing little kids tracing the spiral petroglyphs with the fingers. He'd tell them about the cycle of the salmon. He used to help the kids find the petroglyphs they wanted, then he'd supervise them. And that was before it became illegal to make rubbings. Now they had fake ones on the platforms that tourists could make rubbings from. He supposed it might be for the best. But this summer, someone had spray painted a genuine petroglyph with blue paint. It had been there for 9,000 years, maybe 10,000. Probably weren't the kids, because all the kids he'd met on the beach really liked the glyphs. Charlie took another sip of his hot coffee. Then he remembered he'd stuffed a breakfast roll in his raincoat. He took it out, he ate some, and shared a piece with Osa and a brave gull hopping on a rock nearby. Clouds darkened, moving a sheet of rain toward the shore. He supposed he'd better head back inside. Besides, the beach was clean today, and the man in the green state uniform would be showing up soon. After the last blue paint incident, Charlie was pretty mad, but he'd always been told to think about his words before saying anything. He didn't know what he was going to say yet, but something had to be done. He just didn't know what. Plus, he didn't think the local government or the state of Alaska was used to natives speaking up about things, especially in Wrangell. Recently, his niece Sarah got the city to say that Thlinkits were here first. She had to keep writing letters to them, put stuff in the paper, and finally she called the governor. The city used to say that Wrangell was the first white settlement in Alaska. They forgot all about the Thlinkits who've inhabited the island for thousands of years. Then, in the 1970s, the lawyers left Wrangell Tlingits out of the land claims. He and his friends went to all the meetings, went to D.C., and they still forgot. Said, oops, and went on giving out lands to other tribes. Now they call Wrangell natives the landless. Without the land, we are nothing. Without the rocks, we are nothing. He stood and walked among the rocks, heading back home. Osa followed him, sniffing seaweed along the way. He shook his head. He wasn't landless. It was a strange concept, for sure. He could have claimed this beach instead of the state owning it. Maybe claimed Farm Island at the mouth of the Stikine River instead of the white farmhand and his relatives who owned it now. His dad had hunted and fished there. The river was in his blood. Stikine meant bitter or silty water, not great river like the touristy types call it. Hell, it was silty, and it could be very bitter. The river had even taken a few of his friends' lives. One fell off a riverboat, Madeline Rose. And one winter, another friend went trapping and was found dead, stuck to an ice floe. Charlie nodded to the river, mixing with at the green ocean in front of his house. Respect that river. Respect the rocks. He was nearly to his house when he turned back towards the beach. A small man walked among the petroglyphs. Charlie thought he recognized him. "Morning, Mr. Lee." The man didn't look up. That's when Charlie remembered that old Mr. Lee had been dead for a few years. He and Mr. Lee used to have coffee at the gas station and BS about old times. A long time ago, Mr. Lee had told him that the town folk didn't want the Chinese buried in the white cemetery. They used to cut them up and shove them into barrels and salt them. Then someone was supposed to let the Chinese government know so they can come get their countrymen. Mr. Lee said he didn't know if anyone ever did, but he wasn't going to set foot on Dead Man's Island, that's for sure. The man bent down and rubbed sand off a rock. The spiral petroglyph, Charlie's favorite. The man crouched there, staring at the rock. Finally, Charlie turned back and headed up the beach a little farther to his house. The tide was flowing inwards, already lifting a log from the beach. Soon it would be pitching October waves onto his front porch. Last week, Johan had come to visit. He asked Charlie about moving the house back again. Charlie had said, "I'm not moving back. I'm old. I won't be able to see the petroglyphs if I move to where you want me to anyway. I'll be too close to that damn road." Charlie and his friend Nylon Hedda sipped their coffee and looked out the window. "Big tides are coming, lots of bad weather," Nylon said. "You ready?"
"Ready.
I like your plan, but you're a crazy son of a gun. You know that?" At 3 a.m., 4 days later, on a November night, the dark folded over the island and the wind howled. No one could hear Nylon rolling the bobcat off the back of his lowboy trailer and driving it down the beach. The bobcat heaved the rocks into Charlie's house. Charlie had torn out the 2x4s in the front doorway to make it bigger, then eventually the wall and most of the walls inside his house. Nylon drove right up the makeshift ramp and then set the rocks down in Charlie's living room and in what was once his bedroom and kitchen. The previous week, Johan and two of his buddies had come over and put in styrofoam floats beneath the house. They didn't think it would hold 40 petroglyphs, but some of them wouldn't be able to move anyway. They'd pile in what they could. Now, the house sank down a bit, but the large logs beneath it held. After all the logs were loaded, Nylon put the bobcat away and drove home in the dark. Waves thrashed in the front of the house like a car wash blasting a truck, smashing into the large window. The tide stuck its tongue under the logs and lifted Charlie's house as if it were a piece of candy to be eaten. The house rocked and then lifted, bobbing in the sea. Charlie sat inside in his recliner, the only piece of furniture he had saved. Holding on to the 2x4 post, Osa, as big as he was, jumped into his lap. Osa whined. Maybe this wasn't a good idea. The current shoved the house hard and it thumped. What was that sound? Charlie cringed as he felt the rocks scraping the floats beneath him, but it didn't stop the little house from floating. The storm surged and the wind blew. Out his front windows, the night was so dark, he couldn't see anything. Hanging onto the skeleton frame of his house, he left sofa on the chair and he went to the living room and then the bedroom, looking out the windows. Through his bedroom window, the faint outline of the shore swept by. He was moving fast. Real fast. Charlie sat back down in his chair, trying his best to take sips of his coffee from his thermos, but that's when he heard it. He'd heard that sound before, a howl spiraling by. Nylon, who worked for the Forest Service, had once taken him to Garnet Ledge to show him the destruction left by one of those winds. No one believed Nylon when he'd reported that something like a tornado had torn through the trail, making a swath through the trees. So he'd shown Charlie. Charlie remembered the giant spruce and the hemlock toppled as if they were sticks. Now the house spun around. The wind knocked the windows in. Glass crashed onto the petroglyphs. The house moaned and creaked with each wave that hit it, slopping over the logs. Beneath him, the floorboards wobbled, and a large piece of the float gave way and popped up from beneath the house. One corner of the house sank down, and a piece of float whipped up and hit the roof hard. The house shook. "Crap!" Charlie said to Osa, who was now quivering at his feet. The house rocked and rolled on the waves as he clambered over the rocks on his hands and knees to the corner of the living room where water was seeping in fast. The wind howled and the house twisted again. Finally, the house stopped twisting. It went up and down as if riding huge waves. Charlie looked out the living room windows, and at this time he was face to face with the white froth of a wave at least 10 feet high. "Christ, the size of the waves," he said out loud. He kneeled among the petroglyphs, his hand clutching the 2x4 posts, and hung on for what seemed like hours. Waves and wind bellowed through the house. The house tilted and cracked with a splitting sound. Charlie fell sideways, hitting his head on a rock. Water, waves, and wind roared through his ears as if he had an inner ear infection. He poked to Osa, licking his face. He blinked, trying to adjust his eyes to the darkness, and then reached out and felt around. Beneath him, it felt solid. Should he move? His back hurt. His arm was on fire. He reached to touch his arm, feeling a big gash, sticky with blood. It was then that he realized that the ground wasn't bending like the floorboards of his house. He was lying on a beach in a small piece of his living room floor. He sat up. He could see the airport lights. He was on Dead Man's Island. Crap. He hadn't made it far. The wind had picked him up and slid his house on the waves to the small island. He could make out sand around him and a rocky beach. He stood, patted his dog. Osa dripped with the water, and the old dog stank. Plus, he limped. His tail still wagged. Charlie walked along the shoreline, discovering pieces of his house. A wall with sunflower paper. A log from the float beneath his house. There! A piece of his roof. Over there, a small refrigerator banged against a rock. Crap, he stepped over a rock. Parts of his house were scattered up to the tree line, where he found his recliner upright, as if waiting for him to sit in it and flip the television channels. Maybe he could change this channel. Rain pelted his face, and he rubbed his hand across his partly bald head. He'd always dressed in layers, so he took off his flannel shirt and tied it up like a hood. He walked a few steps farther, and his foot clunked against the rock. He bent down close to the rock, touching it. "What the hell?" he said, feeling the swirl on the rock at his feet. The swirl, he knew, was the symbol for new beginnings in many cultures. Maori, Hawaiian, Tlingit, Finnish. He tried to adjust his eyesight, but it seemed darkness had swallowed up the beach. Maybe he had a head injury. He couldn't tell the rock was a petroglyph until he touched it. Floorboards from his house surrounded him. "Well, Jesse, I've done it now." He didn't know really what he'd done, or at least the consequences, but it'd make a good story anyway. He stepped around the petroglyphs, sunk into the sand. They were stuck too, like he was. Charlie sat down and rested for a minute next to the raven stealing the sun glyph. He traced it with his finger. "Well, Raven," he said out loud, "I guess we'd better build a fire." Up near the tree line, Charlie fumbled with a lighter that was still in his pants pocket. His hands were cold, his thumb barely worked, but eventually he lit it. Moss covered the stumps, stones, and roots so he couldn't see where the graves or the ghosts were. Were the barrels still here? Were there graves, markers? He'd never been here. Never wanted to go here, really. With a lighter held out in the woods, he said, "Ja'ade ye chat na'u." Please forgive me. It was one of the few Thlinkit phrases he knew. In English, he asked the island's dead to forgive him for trudging around. Charlie gathered wood from small stands of trees and found a dry spot under a tree and built a fire. The rain softened to a light mist. The fire lit up the beach, and Charlie sat by the fire, rubbing his hands and over Osa's hair. He stopped mid-stroke, seeing a shadow walk along the beach. Looked like a small man or a child. The person stopped near the spiral rock and bent over. This person never looked in Charlie's direction and in the direction of the fire, but instead traced the spiral pattern over and over. Charlie knew what he was doing, as he'd done the same thing many times, pressing his finger into the backbone of the spiral, letting his mind wander to a centered place in a spiral galaxy, our Milky Way. In the early morning light, the man faded away, and the fire died down to a white ash.
As if smuggling drug money in an old float plane in choppy, low visibility weather isn't stressful enough, add a huge misbehaving dog named Little Brother. Reading a selection from his novel, Cold Storage, please welcome John Straley.
Good evening. I'd like to read from chapter 5, where Clive McCann, having been released from prison in Washington, is traveling with a new dog. This is a former fighting dog, to his old home in Cold Storage, Alaska. Clive's brother is named Miles, and the fighting dog is Little Brother. I think that's all you need to know. The plane dipped into the clouds, rocking from side to side so hard that the seats in the first class cabin creaked in their moorings. Clyde looked out the window and saw a gray world of stone and water below. The waves foamed white on the rocks. Small boats tugged in their anchor lines. The plane buffeted through the wind shear, curling up from the peaks. It shook, banked several times, and landed with a gentle thump. Clive opened his eyes, grateful but regretting that now he had to transfer to an even smaller plane. In the Juneau airport, Clive sat, drank espresso, pushed some muffins through the bars of the kennel. Little Brother's lurid pink tongue licked up the crumb, swept across his fingers, and all the while Clive talked to him in a calm, almost confessional tone. He said, "You're going to like Alaska. Climate's a bit standoffish, but I think you're going to like it." The ugly, earless dog lifted his head and stared at him. Clive leaned in close, listening hard, but all he heard was snuffling breath. The dog's silence was irritating to Clive. It's like a manhole in the dark with the cover taken off by vandals. "And I really expect you'll be wildly popular." Clive and Miles had grown up around planes and bad weather, but he had always hated flying. He had never exchanged stories with the ramp rats who loaded gear into bush planes. He had never cultivated his faith in the physics and mechanics of flight. He wasn't a puker. He just didn't believe that manned flight was possible, no matter what the available evidence told him. He had decided to call a cab, stay in a hotel for the night, and try to fly out again the next day when a woman came around the corner and told him that they were going to give it a try. Clive didn't particularly like the idea of a small plane giving it a try. But he raised his hands, palm up, and shrugged, "Let's do it." The pilot, a howdy doody in a plaid shirt and dungarees, smiled sweetly. "I don't think the kennel's going to fit in the Beaver like that, but that dog can be in the seat with you." Even though he didn't like the sound of it, Clyde had long ago given up on confrontation. The de Havilland Beaver was a single-engine prop plane with landing wheels tucked under the aluminum floats on the undercarriage. It could land on the runway in Juneau and then land on the inlet and cold storage. To Clive, this particular float plane looked like a piece of farm equipment. Little brother stood by himself on the tarmac, his choke chain glittering in the milky sunlight that filtered through the clouds. I just don't know. The pilot's head poked out from the doorway of the plane. I guess your dog wants to wait for you. His voice sounded wary. He seems kind of touchy. I think he's just sensitive. Well, he's going to love the trip. I bet he just sleeps right through it until we land. They usually do. He paused and then looked at the dog. You can handle him, right? He asked. Yeah, no problem. Don't worry about a thing. He's impressive. Yeah, impressive is a good word, Clyde said. Vicious is another good word. The kid loading baggage walked toward the little brother and stopped about 10 feet from the chewing end of the dog's anatomy, and the kid turned his head toward Clyde and he said, "Are you gonna load him up on there with you?" And he said, no, I don't think so, Clive said, and kept climbing. Well, what do you want me to do? The kid's voice quavered, and he said, "Well, if he's still here when we take off, you can keep him." And on the tarmac, little brother looked sleepy. He turned his head one way and then another, and he lowered his head. And he took one small step towards the plane. The luggage kid turned away and walked away from the dog, and the pilot started to crank the engine and close the side door. Then little brother came bounding up the stairs, clambering up the ladder, and jumped into the seat next to him. And Clive carefully patted the muscled hump between the dog's shoulder blades, and the bony creature settled in to the seat, his head on Clive's lap. His breathing filled the cabin with the smell of raw hamburger. The trip west was bumpy, and the plane bucked. The single radial engine blared, and Clive put his fingers in his ears. The thing didn't smooth out as they entered Icy Strait and headed toward the ocean. The plane dipped and rolled against the strong southwesterly wind, and Clive watched the pilot scan the water and the clouds and tried to adjust his altitude to find smoother air, and he kept saying, "Well, it's going to be rough." And according to the pilot, everything would be just fine as long as the visibility stayed good, and Clive quietly gripped little brother's collar and stroked his ears. His head, as big as a fishbowl, settled down to rest on Clive's new parka. The plane jolted up and down, and the two of them closed their eyes. They might both be rattled apart before they got to cold storage. The plane bounced over the mountains of Chichkoff Island. The world below them looked like a cauldron of rock and water and wind. The waves rolled and battered the outer islands, and sweeping spumes of water broke off the tops of the waves. Clive was about to suggest that someone should either give him a parachute or they should all just turn around and fly back to Juneau. He opened his eyes, but before he could open his mouth to say anything more, the pilot pointed to the water, gave a big thumbs up, and then put the plane into a dive. Clive gripped his knees and kept his eyes open. Waves bombarded the aluminum floats. The plane bounced, and then it came to a rest on the surface of the ocean. They were in Pelican. Clive and little brother watched silently as the pilot threw the line out to a bald-headed man in a red raincoat. Slowly, they were pulled up to the dock, and the pilot handed a man a padded mailing envelope. "Great, Tommy," he said. "Thanks for dropping it off. Are you headed over to cold storage?" "Yeah, Harry, I am, as long as the ceiling holds. You got something for me?" And the man reached down, lifted a garbage bag off the dock. "Yeah, you got room to take the salmon over to Miles? I told him I'd give him one this spring. Poor guy can't seem to catch one."
Oh, yeah, sure, I've got room, but don't, you know, but if we don't get it in, I'm keeping it. Is that okay with you?
And Harry looked at him and said, yeah, fine enough. And the man held out a black bag with the salmon heavy in it, and the pilot shoved it in under his own seat. Tommy would take off again and make the short hop to cold storage and then back to Juno and his home. Clive looked out and he remembered Pelican. Everything in Pelican was pushed together along one boardwalk, like some kind of Russian fishing village. Cold storage wasn't anything like Pelican. Pelican has smart children and beautiful girls. At least that's what Clive had always felt. Pelican felt like Paris. To a kid scraping along the boardwalk in cold storage. In the plane, after the rough and bouncy takeoff, little brother could smell the fish. His nose came up off of Clive's lap, his eyes narrowed, starting to look almost primeval, and his muscles tightened. He hadn't eaten well in either of the airports, and the giant dog tried to get down onto the floor of the plane. He rooted and pushed against the seats and pushed against Clive.
Is there a problem?
Tommy yelled over his shoulder. A rocky ridgeline lay just 100 yards in front of them.
Just a few more minutes and we'll be down, Tommy said. Can you keep control of that dog?
Hey, we're fine, Clive called. We're having the time of our lives. And he tried to wrap his new coat around little brother's shoulders, but the dog seemed to be growing. He would soon be the size of a buffalo, Clive thought. Looking over his shoulder, all Tommy could see was a massive rump of a brindled dog pushing against the seat above the roar of the engine, and he could hear was deep growling. Just a few more minutes, someone said in a weak voice. Clive pulled against little brother's collar, but the dog wasn't interested in calming down. He reached back with his teeth and grabbed the coat from around his shoulders. He began to furiously tear at the parka. Feathers and dog slobber flecked against the windscreen. Tommy started pumping the flaps and leveling off for a landing, but $100 bills were floating up over his shoulder and landing in his laps. He pushed the plane down onto the water, closer to the water, harder. Feathers and paper money fluttered through the cabin. The dog snarled, Tommy shrieked, Clive just closed his eyes. When he got to the float, no one was there to meet him. Tommy jumped down and he tried to tie the plane off to a cleat, and he sat on the dock with his butt hard on the wet wood, his head in his hands. $1,000 in assorted bills were plastered to his hair in snot and slobber and blood. And his neck was covered with feathers and more slobber. Coming down the boardwalk to meet them ran a flock of children squealing with short, joyful cries like small seabirds. Miles was walking soberly in their wake. Inside the plane, little brother had finished tearing up Tommy's seat and was busy ripping into the salmon. Blood, scales, red bits of fish spattered on the window. Bills that had been sewn into the coat's lining fluttered like leaves. Tommy picked himself up, turned back, and opened the passenger door. Little brother, the king salmon firmly in his mouth, bounded up the ramp, crossed the boardwalk into two strides, and ran up into the woods. Everyone could hear him breaking through the brush, turning over stones. No one offered to go after him. No one called, no one whistled for the dog to come back. They acted as if he were just another spell of bad luck that had happily passed them by. Clive clutched the ripped bundle of his coat and jumped down onto the floats. He had cut his hand on one of little brother's teeth and was slathered with drool, feathers, and large denomination bills, and his own blood. Miles pointed to the water beside the dock. A slobbery clump of $100 bills floated toward the Aleutian Islands in Japan. I guess that would be your money, he said to his brother. Miles, Clive said softly, but with great joy, opened his arms wide. Come here and hug me, you big lug. Miles shook his head slowly from side to side. Behind him, over his shoulders, trees trembled on the hillside where the big brindled dog was charging up the mountain with the dead fish in his mouth.
Funding for Arts at 360 comes from Northwind Architects and Rainbow Foods of Juneau.